Okay, so on the docket for today, first up, we gotta bake those cookies for little Stacy's bake sale, because you know, those other girls, they can just be so mean, so we want her to feel included and then she's gonna bring the best cookies ever. And then we're gonna run to the mall because we gotta get little Jimmy those new shoes. You know, he's gotta have those Jordans in order for him to feel like the big man on campus. You know, his confidence has been a little weak lately and we want him to feel a little bit better about himself. We're gonna come on home and we're gonna cook that Thanksgiving dinner because Glenn's entire family is coming over, and God forbid, I don't want Aunt Martha to feel excluded like she did last time. So we're gonna have the sweet potatoes, because when we did it and she was so sad, that just broke my whole heart. And then, you know, I gotta donate to that charity, because you know, those kids in Africa, they're starving, and I just can't sleep at night knowing that they're not getting fed. So we've got a lot to do today. I should probably eat some lunch. Hello, my lovely friends. My name is Kate Moriah. I'm a master empath, intuitive healer, and I am here to bring you a video as a part of a big series on what type of empath are you. Today, we're going to be talking about emotional empaths. So maybe today we're going to be talking about, are you an emotional empath? We're going to find out. Or do you have an emotional empath in your life? Do you know someone who may be an emotional empath? Well, first, let's dig in and let's talk about what is an emotional empath. Emotional empaths are beautiful people when they're fully in their strength, when they're fully in their power and fully in their flow. These are the most beloved people within our lives. Emotional empaths, they feel, they experience, and they also absorb the emotions of other people. So, you know, essentially what's going on energetically is the emotional body of consciousness. It can be very porous, especially in the society that we live in, you know, the modern day and age that we are in. Emotions, fortunately, they're getting more and more of a priority, but you know, they have not been, as the way of the world, they have not been a priority. So a lot of times we can find ourselves in an emotional landscape that can be really hard to navigate. And so emotional empaths are these beautiful souls, these beautiful beings that are here now, that are meant to place here to learn how to navigate this emotional landscape, becoming more aware of our emotions, because there's a lot of information in the emotions. There's a lot of healing to be had. There's also a lot of intelligence within our emotions. So fortunately, emotional empaths, one of their charges for their life, one of the main life lessons and main tasks that they have, is to really truly master their own emotions, stay grounded in their own emotions, and also identify when what they're feeling or what they're experiencing or what they're absorbing, or you know, where even their head is at, when it's actually has to do with someone else's emotions, whether they realize it or not. So let's talk about some of the signs and strengths that come with being an emotional empath. An emotional empath has this uncanny ability to respond to the emotional needs of another person, even if that other person isn't fully able to articulate what those emotions or those needs are. And a lot of times, you know, it depends on how aware the empath is.
I feel you, dog.
That's the empathizer's catchphrase.
If you're dealing with like an unhealed, unmanaged empath, they can just be feeling someone else's emotions and not understand, you know, why do I feel uncomfortable right now? Or why do I feel anxious? Why do I feel awkward? Because the other person is not able to articulate what they're feeling. And so then, you know, they're feeling the anxiety, they're feeling awkward, and then the empath is feeling it. Or you can have more of a self-aware, self-conscious, conscientious emotional empath, where it's like, ooh, I'm feeling this person is anxious, and they can actually identify within their own emotional experience what the other person is feeling, and then help and respond to the origin, maybe why they're feeling that way. This also couples in with the emotional empath's ability to understand the emotional motivations that people have, again, even if they don't understand it themselves. So, you know, if someone that they love or that they're connected to, or even just that they're observing is patterning in a way in their life that is either, you know, self-sabotaging or destructive, or maybe even successful and driven, the emotional empath is able to identify what are the emotional motivators behind these actions, behind this charge, right? In order this response and the response cycle. So, I mean, this is incredibly powerful, because a lot of times we can just do things or be a certain way or behave in a certain kind of way. And there's because there's an emotional reason behind it, right? Whether it be pain or love or, you know, idolation or whatever it is. And we may not necessarily be aware of what the emotions are that are factoring into, you know, what certain situations may be, right? So if we're doing something or, you know, we're stuck in a certain way, or if we keep coming across a challenge, there may be some emotional hindrances that an emotional empath will be able to, you know, pluck and identify and help you move through. One of the third indicators that you have an emotional empath on your hands is they tend to offer very maternal or nurturing energies, and it's usually very healing and very validating for other people to have an emotional empath around.
What are you, my mother?
Who use mother?
Maybe.
You are not my mother.
My mother's mother's mother.
You'll see this in the sense that they can often mirror emotions as well. So, you know, if you are in a certain kind of vibe, right, you're in a certain kind of mood, an emotional empath is going to be your, you know, co-pilot, like in that emotion. They'll be able to reflect it back to you. They'll be able to hold space for you. They'll be able to understand that, you know, you kind of need to be there in that moment, in that emotion. And, you know, let's say, you know, you have a, you're in a down mood, an emotional empath will be able to meet you there at a low point and maybe even bring you back up. You know, if you're willing and open to it, bring you back up to a higher vibrational emotion where, you know, essentially you're feeling better. So they can really, you know, emotional empaths, they kiss the boo-boo. You know what I mean? Emotional empaths will kiss the boo-boo. They can see where you're at, meet your needs in that way. And you know, oftentimes this can be, it can border on, you know, if it's in an unhealthy manner, if it's to any kind of extreme, it can be incredibly enabling. You know, it cannot be helpful in some cases. But in a lot of cases, this is an incredible strength that offers a lot of comfort and healing, nurturing energy, and a lot of validation for a lot of individuals. Emotional empaths are also incredible at creating a safe space for others to feel seen, feel heard, feel understood. A lot of times, you know, we can get so caught up in life, things get really, really busy. We can just kind of get into a rhythm, or, you know, there's just so many demands that are placed on us that, you know, we just may become hard, right? Over time, you know, if you've gone through a lot of pain in your life, a lot of loss, a lot of grief, or even trauma, you know, your heart can become hardened, and we can feel like we shrink around other people, and we can disconnect from other people. Whereas an emotional empath will help, you know, draw people that are starting to, you know, shut off and shut down, draw them outside of themselves by creating that safe environment, that safe space. And this could simply just be within a conversation, or just feeling safe within a conversation in order to open up, in order to, you know, maybe say things that that have never been spoken out loud before, or share things that, you know, maybe they've never told another person before. A lot of times you'll find emotional empaths will get like someone's life story within like the first, you know, 15 minutes of meeting a person. And these people will just be like, oh my God, I never told anyone that. I don't know why I felt compelled to share that with you. But it's because of that natural inherent healing nature that an emotional empath offers just organically. Like it's just woven into the fabric of their own beingness. It's really beautiful. Emotional empaths will really truly make awesome partners, spouses, parents, friends, team players, you know, co-captains, you know, business partners. Like they will really be your ride or die. They will be able to be there with you, for you. They'll podcasts, even like if you have a show, if you have like a co-host and you're doing a podcast with someone, they will be able to like track you and keep up with you, because as you move through maybe different storylines or different topics, or you know, you're sharing different things or you're connecting with different people, an emotional empath will be able to meet you there. Oftentimes this can actually be really draining on the emotional empath in order to have, you know, such a variety of frequencies that they're switching in between. But it's an incredible talent to witness when you see it in action. They're able to just meet people where they're at, understand them, see through their own intuition, where a person is coming from, what are their intentions behind certain, you know, questions, actions, decisions, and actually speak to that origin within a person and pull it out of themselves. So really an emotional empath is awesome for partnering up with and also helping to bring people out of their bubble, out of their shell, out of their comfort zone. It's really, it's just incredible to witness. However, the emotional empath does have challenges and struggles. It's not all easy street when you are able to feel and experience and absorb other people's emotions, because not everyone is a great steward of their own emotional landscape. So it kind of puts on a lot of burden and a lot of responsibility onto the emotional empath to take responsibility for themselves and their own emotions. So one of the struggles that an emotional empath will come across is they may start to feel confused or even overwhelmed at times or often as they're being flooded by emotions, which is essentially energy, right? Like when you're absorbing emotions, you're absorbing energy. So, and this is the part of the empath, right? You're absorbing the energy. But you can become flooded with the emotions of other people that may, like I said, it doesn't originate with the empath. It originates from other sources of people that don't necessarily know how to manage their own emotions or their own energy. You know, think about the person who is like, you know, completely stoic on the outside, but inside they're just like internally screaming and like they're on the verge of like having a complete breakdown. But you wouldn't know it by looking at their face. The emotional empath feels all of that. They feel that turmoil. They feel that chaos and that war inside the other person. And that can be a lot to absorb. So, that can get really confusing and overwhelming really quick. Another challenge that emotional empaths may have is injury or illness, because when we have stuck emotional energy, if there's emotional energy that we are housing within our system that has not been released or integrated or processed or even fully resolved, this can often manifest, especially with enough time and especially when it's compounded, this can manifest over time as an injury.
I'm going to hurl.
Or like a reoccurring injury or a chronic illness. And this is why a lot of times you will find emotional empaths, like these very nurturing, loving people, you will find them with chronic health challenges, chronic, issues with the physicality, you know, feeling like no matter what I do, I can't remedy or resolve this problem within my physical body, because the physical body is literally echoing what's happening within the emotional landscape of the empath. And sometimes, especially in, you know, if we're in toxic environments or we're within, you know, chaotic living situations, or we have just a very, very busy and demanding life that the emotional empath is either not aware of or doesn't have enough time to resolve and balance their own emotions, over time this can compound and become like literally a physical problem that they have no other choice, but they have to deal with it. Another challenge that emotional empaths may have is that they may have a tendency to hide from people or you know, just be a hermit. or, you know, they might have addiction issues where they just want to like escape life and they just don't want to feel things altogether, because, you know, feeling everything can be a lot. And if you don't know what you are, you don't know who you are, you don't know what's going on, you don't know where it's coming from, you don't know how to manage it, if you're not given the proper tools, you know, the default, the easy low-hanging fruit to reach for is, I just want to numb out. I just want to escape, or I just want to avoid altogether. So, you know, oftentimes this can be very challenging, because emotional empaths, they can feel the good stuff too, right? They can feel the love, they can feel the joy, they can feel the passion and compassion, right? They can feel the friendship, they can feel all those good, gooey sentimental feelings. But, you know, they can block themselves off from that because maybe they've experienced too many harsh feelings, difficult feelings that are just too heavy. It's just too heavy. So, you know, they may opt to just like numb out completely instead. And lastly, one of the biggest challenges that an emotional empath that is severely mismanaged is may encounter is if they don't develop their gifts and their strengths carefully with intention, they may be diagnosed or labeled with some kind of mood or personality disorder, such as, you know, bipolar or manic depressive, you know, maybe like a personality disorder or borderline, or even just generalized anxiety. And they could be, you know, put on medication. Like, you know, the solution for, you know, most Western medical professionals is to just prescribe medication. And so this doesn't really deal with anything, right? If anything, it just compounds even more burden and further disconnects the emotional empath from their own gifts, their own strengths and abilities. When really, there are so many beautiful ways to develop this gift and so many practical applications that would benefit from working through the difficulty, not, you know, owning the label, not listening to, you know, the quick fix. And again, I'm not a medical health professional. I have to say, whatever, if something feels like a good avenue for you and your healthcare and your mental health, please honor that, honor what feels good. But sometimes I will see this with emotional empaths where they are just so sensitive and they're so absorbent and they feel so much, and the world is just a painful, sucky place most of the time, and people can be so shitty and it's just too much to deal with. And so the easiest, you know, avenue is to just identify with these diagnoses or take the prescription. And so that can really restrict the emotional empath from, you know, living in their true beauty and in their true form. So let's talk about some of the practical applications where an emotional empath can really shine and really use their gifts and natural abilities. So an emotional empath, you will see them just working their magic in any kind of healing field, any kind of like counseling, therapy, any kind of like guide, being a teacher, being a midwife, an energy worker. You'll also see them really successful in any kind of performance roles, like being an actor or a host of something. Even working on political teams in order to help, you know, keep that like that humanitarian edge in order to, you know, connect with the people. Writers and storytellers would be a beautiful application for an emotional empath to really like connect with the reader and evoke these emotions. Marketing as well, and you know, in order to connect with your customer. And unfortunately, this is done all too often in order to sell a product. You know, the marketing campaign is often geared towards, you know, connecting and tapping in with your emotion. Like, you don't want this to happen, so buy our product. But you know, a lot of times an emotional empath can really, you know, make bank in these areas. Or they can, you know, even be excellent motivational speakers, right? Really any kind of area where the need to connect with the audience is there, emotional empaths will like really excel in. So here are five ways that you can actually develop your emotional empathy. If you find that you are an emotional empath by nature, you know, by birthright, you're an emotional empath, but you'd like to strengthen these abilities and strengthen these gifts, my first recommendation to you is that you need to establish your own emotional baseline. So this is, it can be a tough one, right? Like, this can take some time because, like I said, if you're living in a situation where you're really affected by, let's say, your partner's mood or your family's mood, or maybe even like your upbringing, you're kind of in a habitualized pattern to, you know, constantly be at the ready to, you know, take care of other people and take care of their emotional needs before your own. This can take some time to like unlatch yourself from these patterns, or maybe even relationships altogether, and remove yourself from these dynamics to get very, very clear on what is your emotional baseline. What is your foundation and your place of peace? What is your neutral point? And so that would be number one, right? That would be priority number one, because once you know what your baseline is, if a new emotion comes in that doesn't belong to you, doesn't originate with you, you're going to be able to identify it that much more quickly. Be like, oh, this doesn't belong to me. I typically don't feel that way, or this isn't a mood that I'm normally in, or I'm not triggered that easily. And you can recognize when emotion comes in that's actually not yours. Number two, once you've established that baseline, I want you to work on building confidence in your ability of knowing what your baseline is and not doubting yourself. Because especially as an emotional empath, we can get so pulled into being there for other people and just being that emotional support system, that emotional crutch for others, that it's easy for emotional empaths to abandon their baseline. And so build that confidence, right? Strengthen those muscles in your own ability to ground in your own baseline and clear your energy as needed. Number three, develop a practice where you regularly tune into your own emotions. So you're not going to feel neutral about everything at all times, right? You're going to have your own organic emotion come up. And so it's really important that you create space and you prioritize time to tap in and tune in. And this could be, you know, meditation practice. This could be journaling. This could be, you know, talking with a close and trusted friend. This could be in talk therapy, you know, whatever, painting, right? You know, create artistic expression in order for you to move through emotion and tune into it. So really, really prioritize this within your schedule. Like, while you're busy taking care of other people and juggling other people's emotions and other people's needs, make sure that you fit yourself in there somewhere too. Number four, you need to learn how to set boundaries. Just because you, as an emotional empath, you're recognizing the emotional needs of another does not mean that you are here and put on this planet in order to meet those needs. So make sure that you are really, like, with fervor, setting and enforcing your own boundaries. You gotta protect your own energy, my sweet girl. Where am I saying sweet girl? I'm talking to my daughter right now. You gotta set your own boundaries, my friend. And then lastly, number five is to develop a practice to observe emotions in meditation. So emotions have a lot of stickiness to them. We can often become really attached to emotions, like, well, I feel this way about something, and so I'm going to make it a part of my identity, or, you know, whatever, right? Or, you know, this thing happened to me at one point in my life and it made me feel this way, and I'm just going to move through life and I'm going to hang on to that emotion and it's a part of who I am. I would love for you to play with emotional energy in the sense of establishing a meditation time, maybe, you know, putting on some noise canceling headphones or listening to some binaural beats or solfeggio frequencies, and allow things to come up within you that may not be the most comfortable to experience, but the purpose of this practice is to literally just observe. Oh, I'm in my meditation and all of a sudden I'm thinking of that really stupid, embarrassing thing I did when I was 13 in front of the boy that I had a crush on and everyone saw. And now all of a sudden my face is getting red and I'm feeling embarrassed all over again, right? Instead of clinging to that emotion and attaching to it, observe it. Observe it like a parent observing their child having a tantrum, right? Or having a moment of glee and delight, right? Just observe and appreciate it and just release it, right? Let it go. Understand that's not something I need to connect with, I need to anchor to, I don't need to put any meaning or label or assign anything to this emotion. I'm simply practicing observing it, like, oh, that's the emotion of embarrassment and I'm just gonna watch that fly on by. You know, oh, there's an emotion of feeling anxious about something. I'm just gonna let that wash on by and just really spend time in this. And you do this enough, my friends, I'm telling you, dollars to donuts, you do this enough, you are going to master your emotions. You will be a master of your emotions in the sense that people will not be able to trigger you. Lower vibrational energies, you know, instigators and antagonizers will not be able to touch you. People will not be able to manipulate you by pulling at your heartstrings, because here you are observing your emotions, but you have mastered them because you have spent time with your emotions. So hopefully, my friends, this has given you enough nuggets of information and some ideas to play with and start implementing within your own life. And let me know, sound off in the comments below. Do you resonate with this? Are you an emotional empath? Do you know an emotional empath? Do you have one in your life, within your household or your family? Let me know. With that, you guys, that's it for me in this video this week. I will see you guys in the next one. And with that, I am sending you so much love. Bye.